to a presentation on employment law. This is part of a series of presentations for small nonprofits. The goal is to give you some basic information that will help you deal with employment issues and to identify them and to operate your nonprofit properly. This presentation is made available to you by a number of partners: the DC Bar Pro Bono Program, the Pro Bono Partnership, the Pro Bono Partnership of Atlanta, and Lawyers Alliance for New York. I'm Judith Moldover, Senior Staff Attorney for Lawyers Alliance. So we will be talking in the next hour or so about the very, very most major, major issues that come up all the time in employment law. First is the basic concept of at-will employment. We'll also talk about employees versus independent contractors, how you can tell one from the other and why it's critical that you know the difference. We will talk about wage and hour laws, most particularly how much do you pay people legally, what's required, and who gets overtime and who doesn't and why. Discrimination and harassment laws are always seem to be in the news somehow, so we will talk about those and the basic concepts there. Another issue that comes up all the time in working with employees is leaves of absence. When do you have to give them? For what kinds of reasons? For how long? Are they paid? We'll discuss that. And finally, we'll spend a couple of minutes on a unique issue for nonprofits, which is the use of volunteers. Unlike for-profit businesses, nonprofits are allowed to accomplish their work through volunteers, but there are a few legal considerations even there as well. So we will discuss that too. First, let's talk about this concept of employment at will. You've probably heard it used. You may have wondered what it means. It's a judge-made concept that's very old, and it is still good law unless there is some exception somewhere. And the basic idea is that an employee is employed at will, meaning either the employee can quit anytime he or she wants to, and the employer can terminate the employment relationship at any time, with or without notice, or with or without cause, unless there is a law that prevents it, the employer has adopted a particular policy, or there is a contract. Frequently, more high-level employees, like an executive director, may have a contract that provides many of the terms and conditions of employment, including the circumstances under which the employment can end. Also, in regard to the end of employment, just so you know, there is no law out there anywhere that says employers must pay severance. On the other hand, if there is a policy or a contract in place that requires the employer to pay severance, then you would have to do that. Next. So as you can see, being an at-will employer is generally a good thing. It gives the employer maximum flexibility to change the workforce as needed or to change a particular individual's status as needed. So generally you want to maintain that at-will status. That means that you don't give anyone an employment contract without thinking through whether that's what you really want to do with that particular person. Certainly get an attorney to look at that contract, make sure it's well drafted. If you have a written employee handbook, that's another thing that's not legally required, but it's certainly a best practice. And that handbook should say at the beginning or at the end or both places that employees are at will. If you have your employees sign a receipt for the handbook, it should not merely say, oh yes, I've gotten the handbook, but that's another opportunity to repeat and have the employee acknowledge that employment is at will. Finally, make sure that in addition to your handbook, all other written documents that refer to the employment relationship are very clear that employment is at will, such as an offer letter. I know it doesn't sound very friendly to say, hi, welcome, and by the way, you're at will, and we can get rid of you anytime. But the reality is, that's really what you should say. It is a best practice. And any other types of written agreement, even, or document, even a 60-day written warning. You're not promising the person that they can work for you for 60 days. You might want to terminate them sooner if their performance is really going downhill very rapidly. So you always want to make sure that anytime you've written something that refers to a length of time, unless you intend to create an employment contract, you need to remember to state this does not create a contract and you are still an employee at will. So next we will turn to one of the most vexing issues in employment law, which is who's an employee, who's an independent contractor. And the reason it's so difficult is that there is no terrific definition anywhere, because relationships, working paid working relationships, are different. They may have different factors or different circumstances. So it is probably impossible to write a law, for instance, that defines independent contractors. The best that can happen is that a government agency that's trying to regulate and provide things for employees versus independent contractors may list a whole bunch of factors. The main thing to keep in mind is this. Who's really controlling how the work gets done? That's really critical. And then all these kind of factors, and we'll talk about a few of them in a minute, are really what a court, for instance, or a Department of Labor, if somebody claims unemployment insurance, will look at in trying to figure out what is this relationship really. And as the employer, you are always going to be the person or the putative employer, in case you think it's an independent contractor arrangement. You are the one that's going to have to prove, have the burden of proof to the court, to the unemployment insurance, to whoever is trying to make the decision on what the status actually is. So for all of the folks you have that you think are independent contractors, for instance, you really need to look at exactly what those people are doing and what that relationship is. Next. So we said before factors. So here are some of the factors. Who controls where the person works and when? Usually, an independent contractor is someone who is in some kind of business, and they're making the determination of when they're going to do the work and how and what equipment they're going to use and what they need, and even if they need other people to help them finish that work. That's all part of being in business and fulfilling a contract, which is basically what an independent contractor does. If you think of independent contractors as individuals who are supplying a result, they are engaged, not hired, they are engaged to produce a result for you, then it becomes a little easier to look at some of these individual factors and figure out which way they cut. If you are buying materials, except perhaps paint for a painter, because you have to buy the color you want, but if you are providing a computer program for someone or you are providing tools, that starts to look like they're not really in business for themselves and walking around with their own equipment, right? You are supplying the equipment. If you're doing that, then they are more likely to be an employee. Also, an independent contractor, again, because they are engaged only to produce a result for you, can decide if they want to do this work themselves or if they want to hire someone to do your work while they go off and do somebody else's work, thereby leveraging the amount of money they can make by using employees. They're allowed to do that. Obviously, if you think about your own employees, your own employee can never, or not for long, because you would probably have very good grounds to fire them, hire, you know, their brother-in-law to show up at work and do their job. It's not even thinkable. So that's an important difference there, too. Training is an important factor. Independent contractors are supposed to have expertise in whatever it is that they're doing for you. They don't need to be trained. They might need to be told how your computer system is set up so that they can help you if it's an IT engagement, but they're not being trained in the first instance. Whereas your own employees, you perhaps are training because you need them to do something, and they're not in business. You have to provide the training for them. Also, next is a very important factor here is how is the worker paid? Your employees, hopefully, are paid weekly or biweekly through your payroll system where you've outsourced payroll, but they're on a regular paycheck schedule because they're your employee. An independent contractor is running a business. They don't just automatically get paid. They have to send you a bill, an invoice. Also, typically, an independent contractor is being paid to finish a project. If it's a very long project, they might be paid in installments over the course of months or weeks. But they don't get paid automatically, and they generally get paid some kind of fee, you know, some kind of overall flat amount for doing the work, whereas your employees will be paid by the hour or by the week. Some exceptions apply. For instance, IT contractors tend to get paid by the hour, but generally speaking, they get paid by the project. Workers' expenses, that's an error I see very often in independent contractor agreements. Independent contractors are in business for themselves. When they negotiate with you as to how much they want to get paid for the project, they're supposed to factor in things like their routine business expenses, which might even include parking or telephone or copying. If you're reimbursing for routine expenses like that, that sounds like an employee, or for that matter, an employee probably wouldn't even pay for routine expenses like copying. But if your employee is in sales and has to take someone to lunch to complete a deal, they're going to be reimbursed. That is not true of your independent contractors, with the exception perhaps of some extraordinary expense that they need to do the work for you. Does the person advertise services to the public? Well, your employee hopefully isn't doing that, right? Because they're supposed to be spending their time when they're working for you doing your work. But by the same token, for an independent contractor, they are in business for themselves, and the Department of Labor, for instance, actually wants to see business cards and websites and other indication that the person is holding their services out to the public. There needs to be a written contract. You can't have an independent contractor relationship without a contract. So even if the relationship is legitimately that of independent contractor, and a lot of these things we just discussed are true, the person has to invoice, they're doing a particular project, they have special expertise, they control the when, where, and how of when it's done, all of that. If there's nothing in writing, then they will still be considered legally an employee. And by the same token, if you have an independent contractor agreement and it's poorly drafted so that it starts to look like they're really an employee, then that's a problem too. So very important if you're going to use independent contractors to make sure that an attorney who's familiar with this issue has actually looked at the agreement for you. A couple of other things are, is the relationship permanent? It's generally not a good idea to have an ongoing, forever, indefinite relationship with someone who is an independent contractor, because then that starts to look like, isn't this really an employee at will? Generally speaking, again, individuals are hired for a project. Even if you have a consultant you love and you use them frequently, you should probably have a contract that specifies a particular term. can give that person a new one when that period is up, but you don't want to have a contract that just has no limit to it. Also, to the extent that the quote-unquote contractor is doing work that your other employees are doing, it's a little hard to explain in that situation why one of these people who's doing exactly the same work is an independent contractor and somebody else isn't. And finally, it's not on here, but the number of hours has nothing to do with the relationship. There is a real urban myth out there that as long as someone works part-time, then they're an independent contractor. Very often, nonprofits start to tell me about their bookkeeper, their independent contractor bookkeeper, who's there 3 days a week. Well, that sounds like a part-time employee, not an independent contractor, unless the bookkeeper is in the business of being a bookkeeper for many, many different organizations and is actively pursuing business. Oh, next. So, we've talked a little bit about who's an employee, who's an independent contractor, and again, as you can sense already, it's not always crystal clear. So this is an area where you really do need to get good legal help to make sure you're doing it right. And again, why is this right? Because as an employer, you have a whole raft of obligations to individuals who are your employees. The most important one, as far as the government is concerned, is if you have an employee, they are being paid off payroll, and you are withholding taxes. Just so you know, this is considered so important because the IRS wants its money, as does your state taxing authority, that officers and directors of your organization can actually be held personally liable for unpaid employment tax. It's kind of an exception to the general rule that nonprofit directors are not going to be personally liable. So this is something where you really need to get your organization to set up and take notice. Conversely, if an individual is an independent contractor, you don't have to withhold anything, and in fact, you don't even have to report on a 1099 to the IRS unless the independent contractor has earned more than $600 in a year from you. I might also add as a little note that because taxes are not withheld from independent contractor compensation, a lot of people would be delighted to be an independent contractor and in fact may tell you, your organization, no, I don't want to be an employee. I want to get that full money. I want the float until next April. And please do not make me an employee. Your response to that has to be, sorry, either I put you on the payroll because you're an employee, or we can't do business. Why? Because as the employer, you are the entity that's responsible for withholding taxes. And if you don't do that, even if you suspected that the person was an employee and you begged them and they said, no, I'm only doing this as an independent contractor, guess what? That's not a defense. You're still going to be on the hook for those unpaid taxes, for interest, for penalties, and again, your directors could even be personally liable if the organization can't come up with the money. So that's enough about taxes, but that's usually the main enchilada. But there are other considerations here. For instance, an independent contractor doesn't get workers' compensation coverage, doesn't get unemployment benefits, but if you've misclassified an individual, even at their request, and they get hurt, and you didn't have coverage, you could be subject in probably every state in the union, certainly here in New York, for very, very, very severe penalties, even criminal penalties, if someone's actually hurt and you had no coverage for them. Similarly, with unemployment benefits, comes up all the time. Somebody that you thought was an independent contractor is out of work for a while. They file for unemployment. You get the little form from your state unemployment insurance department, and you write back and say, no, so-and-so was an independent contractor. And then you're off to the races because that person may be saying, well, no, I'm not really. I was really an employee. And then it's up to you to have to defend the classification. And if the Department of Labor thinks you're wrong, they will come in and they'll audit you. And you could have to display books for all of your independent contractors, even those that are probably legitimate. So another good reason to do this right. Independent contractors are not covered by an organization's employee benefit plans, but again, if they're misclassified, they may have a claim for benefits that they should have gotten but did not. Also, independent contractors generally are not covered by employment discrimination laws, except here in New York City, where for some interesting reason, independent contractors are covered. So, next slide. So again, as I said before, even if you agree and the other individual agrees that someone's, you know, that they want to be an independent contractor, if they really should have been an employee, then you as the employer will be on the hook. Another thing that wasn't on the slide, but it could be in some cases that somebody is misclassified was really an employee and perhaps they didn't get minimum wage or they didn't get overtime. That's something else your organization would be on the hook for. So, how are you going to mitigate the risk? Because as you can see, they're quite serious risks for misclassifying individuals. First is to have job descriptions for people who you know are your employees. So have something that states clearly, here's a job, you're an employee, here's what we want you to do. And on the other hand, if you think someone's an independent contractor, you should have a well-drafted independent contractor agreement. But even if it's well-drafted, if that particular individual is not truly an independent contractor, you could still get into trouble legally for failing to fulfill your employer obligations, which is why you should always have an attorney to help you work through these issues. Next. So now we will turn to individuals who you know for sure are your employees. One of the most important obligations you have to your employees is to actually pay them according to the wage and hour laws that apply. The Fair Labor Standards Act is a federal law. It covers nonprofits as well as for-profit businesses. The very unique exception to nonprofits that almost never applies. So just assume that even though you're a nonprofit, you are subject to the federal wage and hour laws. Basically, what that says is that everyone in the U.S., with a few exceptions, are covered by a minimum wage. Minimum wage just went up to $7.25 an hour. And the law also states that everyone in the United States has to get overtime unless they fall under some exemption. And that's the exception, is the exemption from overtime. So you have to assume that somebody's eligible for overtime unless they fall into one of the exemptions. I mentioned before that the federal minimum wage just went up to $7.25 an hour. You may know that for federal contractors, that rate is even higher. States and even cities are permitted to have their own wage and hour laws so that individuals living in those states or cities may be entitled to an even higher minimum wage. The only thing a local jurisdiction can't do is set a minimum wage that's lower than the federal minimum. Here in New York, for instance, our minimum wage is $8 an hour. Now, overtime, we talked about before, that's a really important concept. You need to make sure you understand those rules. By the way, the Federal Department of Labor has a very good website with very clear explanations about this. I believe their website is just simply www.dol.gov, but you can always just Google U.S. Department of Labor, and you'll get to that website. Next. So, excuse me. In order to determine whether one of your employees is exempt from this overtime requirement, the employee has to meet three conditions. One is they have to be paid a salary. The second is they have to be paid a certain minimum salary. The federal law is $455 a week. States that have a higher minimum wage will also have a higher minimum salary for exempt employees. And the exempt employee has to be doing certain duties, which we'll get to in a moment. So, again, first requirement is that your exempt employee makes a certain amount of money. The second is that they get paid a salary. Excuse me. So if your exempt employee gets paid by the hour, except for computer professionals, guess what? They are not exempt. And excuse me again. They have to be paid a salary. And on the other hand, you could have a non-exempt employee who gets a salary because their duty, they get a salary, but they're below $455. Or their duties just aren't included in exempt salaries. So in that case, the salaried person still gets overtime. So that's another common urban myth here. A lot of groups think that, oh, the receptionist gets a salary and we don't have to pay them overtime. But that's not true. Because even if you pay them $500 a week and they get a salary, if they're performing receptionist duties, those are not exempt. If you've misclassified someone as exempt when they should have been non-exempt, and they or the Department of Labor brings an action on their behalf, you may owe them that back unpaid overtime for as much as 2 years, and in some cases, 3 years. And that also presents a problem because you owe them overtime, but because you didn't think you had to pay overtime, you may not have been tracking their hours. In that case, the employee very often just happens to have notes that they took. And if you can't produce any evidence to refute those notes, that's how the overtime is going to be calculated. Next. So now we'll talk about, what are these exemptions? What are the duties that will make an employee who's getting paid a salary and being paid at least $455 a week, again, could be more in some jurisdictions. So what kind of work do these people have to do in order to be exempt? There are actually many exemptions, but the ones that one normally encounters in a nonprofit are the ones that are listed here. So, first is executive. So how do you spot an executive employee? They're the easiest. They have to supervise at least 2 full-time employees or 4 half-time employees, you get the idea. But they have, they are supervising at least 2 people. And they don't merely, help assign them some work day to day. They're not the person who says, yeah, you can go on break now. They actually have to manage them. That means they have authority to hire and fire people and to really manage them, to recommend salary increases, promotions, to perform evaluations. They're exercising independent judgment and discretion about how individual employees under their control are going to be treated. An administrative exempt is a little harder to define. These folks do office work, they certainly don't do any kind of manual work, and they do tasks that are related to management or operations of your nonprofit. So they may not supervise anybody, but for instance, if they set the HR policies, they set financial policies, they're the chief administrative person, then they may be exempt as long as they also exercise independent judgment and discretion on matters of significance. And again, they may have to go to an ED for final authority, for instance, to do business with a particular insurer in the case of a risk manager, but they're the person whose recommendation is likely to be followed. Professionals are nonprofits. Some nonprofits even have their own in-house attorneys. Certainly, some will have social workers, teachers, CPAs, perhaps. Any job that requires formal training, and often formal specialized training, I should say, too, not really any BA in the humanities, but something that is either in business or a professional degree, such as a law degree. Sometimes professionals have licenses, although not necessarily. And then finally, computer employees are generally speaking also exempt if they're high level, they're systems analysts. They're not just like the help desk person, but the person who, for instance, runs IT for your organization. That person could also be administrative. People, individuals can fall sometimes into more than one of these exemptions. So, next. Something to keep in mind is that even though nonprofits can have volunteers, your actual employees who you pay have to be paid for all the hours that they work. They can't just say, oh, no problem, I'll just sort of work during lunch, or I'll come in early, you don't have to pay me. You know, your hourly employees have to be paid for all the time they actually work. Another thing to keep in mind is the overeager employee who works overtime. You haven't budgeted for them to work overtime. You don't want them to work overtime. Nevertheless, they want the money, or they just are really conscientious. They really want to finish some project. They go ahead and work overtime. Even though you said, no, I don't want you to work overtime, even though you may have a policy that says, employees must get permission from their supervisor before they work overtime. Guess what? If they've actually worked the overtime, you have to pay them for it. Your remedy is not to say, I never asked you to work the overtime. Too bad, I'm not paying. You have to pay it. You can discipline someone who works overtime without permission, but you can't withhold the money. Next. Comp time. Now, here's another urban myth that I actually haven't heard in a long time, but just so that you know, you cannot pay, in quotes, your non-exempt employees with comp time instead of overtime. People get confused because a lot of people in nonprofits have also worked in government. The government lets its own employees take comp time, but they don't let anybody else give comp time. So if somebody, a non-exempt person has worked 50 hours some week, then you owe them 10 hours of overtime. Even if, by the way, you pay your employees on a biweekly payroll, and most organizations do, you can't average. You can't say, oh, they worked 50 hours in the first week of the biweekly pay period, and 30 hours in the second week. So on average, they worked 40 hours in both weeks, so I don't owe overtime. No. If they work 50 hours in either one of the 2 weeks in the biweekly pay period, then they have to get overtime pay. That 10 hours of overtime must be paid. It must be reflected in the pay stub. However, you can adjust the person's hours. This would usually be in the second part of the biweekly payroll period, so that they work 1.5 times fewer hours than normal, so that overall you end up paying the same amount of money. But in the first instance, you still are paying them overtime for the overtime that they actually worked. So, next. Here are some other issues that come up around paying people. There's actually no law that says you have to pay vacation pay. It's a best practice, but I'm not aware of any law, maybe in some state, but none that I'm aware of, that you have to pay people for vacation, or you have to pay them for holidays, or even for sick time off under federal law. However, there are a growing number, although it's still only a handful, of states and even cities that require sick leave and sometimes sick pay. So Connecticut is one, D.C., New York State and Virginia. These are some of the states that we think you may well be sitting in as you're listening to this. Sick leave is not required. New York City, after much controversy, finally, as of April 1st of this year, 2014, has a requirement that all employers have to grant basically the equivalent of 50 days sick leave to employees, even very part-time employees. If an employer in New York City has more than 5 employees, those 5 sick days have to be paid, although vacation days and other time off can be used. By the way, in connection with overtime and figuring out how much an employee has worked, so you can figure out if they've worked for more than 40 hours and are owed overtime, paid time off, though they're getting paid, such as a vacation day or a sick day or personal day that's paid, does not count toward the number of hours worked. It's time that's actually worked that counts toward the 40 that trigger overtime. Next. So what do you do? So that sounds like a pretty big liability you could face if you owe overtime and you haven't been paying it. So a couple of things here that are helpful. First is, again, as with independent contractors, it's sometimes actually difficult to figure out if somebody is truly exempt or not. And some states may have some heightened requirements that are not reflected in the federal law that we just discussed. So again, get an attorney. Very often you can find pro bono attorneys that will do this kind of work. So make sure that you have figured out in your work, not only who's an employee, but among your employees, who's eligible for overtime, who is not. Make sure there's a job description for every position that's actually accurate, because those job descriptions will help show whether or not someone's exempt from overtime. Finally, for those employees who you know are non-exempt, make sure that there are accurate payroll records, or I should say accurate timesheets, which will be, of course, important in making sure they're paid properly. Keep the records for at least 2 years under federal law, but some states have a much longer period during which an action for unpaid pay or unpaid overtime can be brought. For instance, here in New York, that is 6 years. So don't throw out those timesheets just yet. You know, make sure you understand how long you need to keep them. Make sure that your employees, not just you, understand who's eligible for overtime and who isn't. In fact, in New York State, there's a law that actually requires either in the offer letter or in a separate document signed by a new hire, a statement of whether or not the person's eligible for overtime, and if so, what their overtime rate will be. I mentioned this earlier, but again, helpful to have a written policy that overtime be approved in advance. But again, even if somebody works without getting that approval, you will have to pay them. Next. So now we're going to turn to a different area of the law that is also extremely important. And again, in terms of anti-harassment and anti-discrimination laws, nonprofits do not get a pass. They are subject to these laws the same as any other employer. Unlike the wage and hour laws that basically cover everyone, the discrimination laws are generally based on the size of the employer. And the intent is always that very, very tiny employers just don't have to comply, you know, if they're only a couple of employees. The federal laws cover groups, employers with at least 15 employees, except for one particular type of discrimination, age, which for some reason, never understood, you have to have 20 employees to be covered by that law. And what the federal law does is say that employers that are covered may not discriminate in employment, in any aspect of employment, hiring, compensation, job assignments, opportunities for special training, even where somebody is being seated, discipline, and termination on the basis of one of these reasons, which are referred to as protected categories. Race, color, religion, gender, national origin, disability, pregnancy, genetic background, or age. So all of these are protected categories. Basically, if an individual is in a protected category, an employer cannot make job-related decisions, unfavorable discriminatory decisions, based on that person's protected categories. And some individuals may be in more than one. In addition, there are actually two types of protected categories, disability and also religion, where an employer has to do more than merely not discriminate. For instance, if an employee is, or applicant even, is disabled, then the employer must provide for a reasonable accommodation of the person's disability. For instance, somebody's in a wheelchair, they need a ramp for access in and out of the building, then the employer must provide that reasonable accommodation, unless providing that accommodation would present an undue hardship. It's too expensive. It's too unworkable. It impacts too heavily on other employees. That kind of consideration. Similarly, with religious practices, either an individual wants to take Sabbath to observe the Sabbath holiday, or an individual has certain dress that they want to wear that is part of their religious practice, the employer has to allow them to take that day off or to wear that religious garb, unless that would impose an undue hardship on the employer. There's a lot more to it than that, but that's the basic concept. So next. So some states and some cities are more expensive than federal law, both in the number of employers that are covered and in the types of characteristics that are protected categories. For instance, Connecticut covers employers with as few as 3 employees. And in addition to what we already discussed under federal law, there's some additional categories such as ancestry, a learning disability, which under federal law would just be a type of disability, marital status. So you can't, for instance, say, oh, we don't hire divorced men, we don't hire single women or single mothers. Creed is probably under religion under the federal law, but this is spelled out here. Sexual orientation is not a protected category under federal law. It nearly became a protected category, and then that legislation did not make it all the way through Congress. My prediction is it will actually make it through Congress one of these days if they ever get functional again, but for now, sexual orientation is a protected category only in some states. D.C. all you need is one employee. And DC also has many of the same categories we've just mentioned earlier. But in addition, political affiliation, that's a good one for DC with so many government employees there. Personal appearance, that's very unusual. I think DC may be the only jurisdiction in the country that actually has personal appearance as a protected category. So, for instance, someone is homely and they don't get hired as a salesperson, might be able to bring a claim in DC. Georgia has 15 employees, except genetic characteristics. But again, once an employer has 15 employees, they are covered under the federal law. Maryland does also have sexual orientation. I think we have some more to look at, some more states. Next slide. New Jersey also has a very broad number of protected categories, and again, only one employee, one or more, specifically covers HIV and AIDS. That is considered protected as a disability under federal law. Military service is covered. It's covered in New York State as well. And I should mention, it wasn't in the slide, but there's a federal statute that basically prohibits discrimination on the basis of military service and provides for very favorable treatment for employees who leave because they are called to active military duty. They have very important reinstatement rights. New York City recognizes transgender status as beyond sexual orientation, also recognizes gender identity, also recognizes domestic violence, being a victim of arrest of domestic violence. It's also the status, didn't make it here because it's also very new. New York City even includes having the status of being an unemployed person. You can't not hire someone in New York City merely because they've been unemployed. Virginia covers between 5 and 15. My guess is the Virginia legislature didn't want to reduplicate what Congress has already passed. So if you have 5 employees but fewer than 15, you're under Virginia state law. Over that, you're out under the federal laws. Next. So as you can see, there are quite a few. So the takeaway from this is to make sure you understand in your state, and if you're in a city, your city, what the discrimination laws. You know, are you covered? What protected categories are covered? And just make sure you understand that. Not that you want to intentionally discriminate against anybody, but for instance, if you have an EEO statement in your employee handbook, you want to make sure that you cover all the categories that you should be covering. Harassment. Harassment is actually sort of a type of discrimination. It's kind of a subset of discrimination. The one that gets the most publicity because the fact patterns of these cases often get into the newspapers and the media because they're often quite sensational. So that's why you hear about sexual harassment more than some of the other types of harassment. The most egregious type of sexual harassment is what's called quid pro quo. That is the classic where employment decision is based on an employee's submission to or rejection of sexual advances or favors, etc. So that's an environment where, you know, employees have to submit to sexual conduct with their supervisors in order to keep their job or to get a good raise or a good evaluation or a promotion. That is pretty egregious. Behavior, so that if an employee is subject to that behavior and they get fired or they quit, the employer is going to be liable for that, you know, for their back pay if they're unemployed for a period of time after quitting or being fired because of the supervisor's conduct. Fortunately, that is not as common as the other type of harassment, which is the hostile work environment. This is where nobody is like saying, you know, you have to put out or else, but it's where the employee is subject to a really hostile or offensive environment, which is created either by supervisors or by coworkers, you know, constant, like, you know, this disgusting jokes that go around on email chains, and somebody doesn't want to be on the chain, but somebody keeps sending them this stuff. Somebody puts up a picture, they make comments, could be even touching, could be constant references to an individual's own sexual activity, and everybody else around them is forced to listen. And it includes the same-sex sexual harassment. It doesn't have to be male on female, which is the usual one that one thinks of. It could be two men, could be two women. That would still count as sexual harassment. There are other types of harassment, too. Any other protected categories can also create a cause of action if somebody constantly spouts racial epithets or draws swastikas or makes fun of somebody's foreign accent or throws a piece of ham onto a Muslim's desk, etc. It's anything that, again, creates a harmful or offensive atmosphere. And if the employer knew or should have known that this kind of activity was going on and did nothing to stop it, they are going to be liable for an individual employee who, you know, was harmed, either lost a job or just, you know, was so offended by this conduct. Next. An organization can be liable for harassment that is caused by somebody other than an employee. So harassment, of course, can be at the hands of a supervisor or a coworker. But in addition, if harassing behavior is entered into by a contractor, a consultant, a volunteer, somebody on the board of directors, a vendor, an employee of a vendor. The classic is the FedEx guy who keeps asking the receptionist for a date. Even a donor in the nonprofit context who's around a lot. Your clients in a nonprofit, if they are harassing your employees and creating a harmful environment, you can be liable for their activity as well. So bottom line is you have to maintain a harassment-free environment. So if you see something going on, your managers see something going on, you have to train your managers and supervisors to realize that they have to report stuff, you know, even if it's something that they're not engaging in, or some employee doesn't report to them, comes to one of your supervisors and says, some other supervisor is harassing me, or some coworker is harassing me, or some volunteer is harassing me. Your supervisor is considered you, right? Because your organization can only act through its employees and supervisors. So you will be liable if your supervisor knew that some arguably harassing behavior was going on and did not report it, did nothing to stop it. Very important to train your supervisors as well as your employees. Next. Another area of discrimination and harassment law that's very important is retaliation. And in fact, all employment laws have anti-retaliation provisions, because generally, employees who complain about work are not too popular with their supervisors, and particularly a supervisor who's been accused of harassment, whether or not they actually did it. So what the law says is if somebody in good faith, somebody, if an employee in good faith has made a complaint, a especially externally or could even be internally, that they've been discriminated against or they've been harassed, or they didn't make a complaint themselves, but somebody they know did and they cooperated in that investigation, then they are protected against retaliation. It's a very important public policy because otherwise nobody would come forward to make sure that these laws get enforced. So what is retaliation? Retaliation clearly is firing somebody who complained or giving them a really bad review or not promoting them even though they deserved it and otherwise would have been promoted. But it's beyond that too. It is any kind of negative kind of conduct that would discourage an employee from bringing forward good faith claims. For instance, it could be firing the employee's fiancé. Could be conduct that goes outside of the workplace. Could be filing a criminal complaint against an employee, a bogus criminal complaint against an employee who made a workplace harassment or discrimination complaint. So very important, if you're aware that an employee has been complaining, keep a lookout that nothing bad happens to them. Now, it's not to say that they're bulletproof forever. If they do something that deserves discipline and you would normally discipline someone for that behavior, yeah, of course, the fact that they complained doesn't mean that, you know, you can't discipline this person as well. But make sure you get good legal advice before you do that. Next. So, how do you protect your organization from harassment claims and discrimination claims? Make sure that you have a written policy that states that as an organization, you prohibit harassment, you don't approve of it, you don't approve discrimination. Make sure there is some kind of a procedure where employees can complain internally. And once you have that in place, make sure that you do actually follow it. Make sure your employees, and especially your supervising employees, and even your volunteers and your board members get training about your discrimination policies, your harassment policies. Make sure they understand, if they're an employee, where to go and what to do if they want to make a complaint. And if they're a supervisor who's aware of a complaint, or even the person against whom the complaint is made, that the supervisors are aware of their obligations. Be, again, as I just said, be on the lookout for retaliation. It's human nature, frankly. Supervisors don't like it when employees complain about them. You can't blame them. So just make sure you give that supervisor extra support. Make sure that you review employment-related decisions about the individual who made a complaint. And finally, just make sure that employment decisions are focused on somebody's ability or not to perform their job. So next. Leaves of absence. This is probably the trickiest part of managing your employees. Larger organizations, those organizations that have at least 50 employees, that could also include part-time people, so it's 50 employees on the payroll for at least 20 weeks in the current or prior year. So if you're sort of getting up there, you have 40-odd employees and some extras, make sure you get good advice as to whether or not you're covered by this federal law, the Family Medical Leave Act. If you are covered, then that means that your eligible employees are entitled to take up to 12 weeks of leave during which their physicians are protected. They are entitled to be reinstated in most cases, even though they've taken up to 12 weeks of leave, if the leave is for their own serious medical condition or for the birth or adoption or foster placement of a child or for a spouse, child, or parent's serious medical condition. The employee needs to be eligible. Employees are eligible if they've worked for your organization for at least 12 months. And the 12 months may have been taken in increments. It could be someone who works every summer or did that for a couple of years and then finally became full-time. So you have to, it's not 12 consecutive months, it's a total of 12 months. And in addition, in the 12-month period before the leave is supposed to start, the individual must have worked at least 1,250 hours in order to be eligible. There also has to be other employees working within a certain distance from them. So if your nonprofit is in a rural area and you have many sites and they're spread out over many miles, get legal help to understand if any one employee of yours is actually eligible for leave, even though you technically may be covered if you have 50 employees. You don't have to pay for the leave, but you can permit employees to use any accrued vacation or sick leave, sick pay or long-term sick pay or other kinds of pay that they have. And in fact, you can even require them to use some of that paid time off, because otherwise the person could take the 12 weeks under Family Medical Leave Act and come back and then take another 4 weeks of vacation. So you have to think about how you want to require employees to use leave. Also, the 12 weeks do not have to be taken in one solid block of 12 weeks. Could be a few weeks here and there throughout a 12-week period. And it could even be in periods of reduced leave where they work a partial days or partial weeks. But in that case, you really have to track it carefully because the employee is still entitled to a total of 12 weeks. Next. So what about if you don't qualify for this federal FMLA because you're too small? You still need to check, because some states, such as New Jersey, which I believe have the first state law, and Connecticut do have their own version of Family Medical Leave Act. The D.C. Area has its own FMLA Act, and that's if you only have 20 employees. What if you don't have, and what if you don't qualify under any state or city law? Then you have to look to your own policies, which you can have. Again, don't forget military service, because this law that I mentioned earlier, USERRA, the federal law, requires that time off be given for military service. The FMLA also has special provisions for taking care of family members who have been seriously injured on active duty, as well as for individuals who've been injured. Next. Volunteers. So as I said earlier, nonprofits are absolutely unique in that you are allowed to have volunteers. So volunteers actually perform services for you without getting paid. Many startup organizations operate for even a few years until their funding gets really firmly established as all volunteer organizations. Some organizations have been around for a long time, and philosophically, they want to be an all-volunteer organization for their own philosophical or programmatic reasons. So that's all fine. So what does it mean? It means the individual does not expect to get compensation. But if your organization normally compensates people for doing exactly the same thing, then that may raise some issues about that individual's status. So you need to look at that. Some organizations have been taken to task, nonprofits that frankly have been abusing folks who are coming out of off of welfare or recently incarcerated, where theoretically they're in work training programs, but the reality is they're not getting trained, they're just getting exploited. So that's why some of these questions are here. You know, what type of work are these alleged volunteers doing? Also, you cannot have someone volunteer for you for a month or two as a tryout and say, oh, yeah, work, volunteer. I'll take advantage. I'm a nonprofit. I can just have somebody volunteer for a few months before I decide whether or not to hire them. Now, if it's work that you normally pay for, you need an employee, then you have to take your chances and hire the person. If they don't work out, you terminate them. It's a little different from someone who's been volunteering and you happen to have an actual paid position, especially if it's something different from what they've been doing as a volunteer, and they want to work for you for money and they become an employee. That's obviously okay. Next. Here's something you need to be careful of, which is, oh, I'm a nonprofit. I can have volunteers. So what about my paid employee? Can they volunteer, especially for a non-exempt person? You know, can they work extra? They say, oh, well, I'll work extra. You don't have to pay me the overtime. No, you cannot allow them to do that. A non-exempt employee doing their own job always has to be paid for their regular work. What you can do is allow a non-exempt employee to volunteer to do something that's not their normal work, that's not during their normal workday. So, for instance, if your nonprofit is holding a face painting fair, and your bookkeeper volunteers to come in on Saturday, not his or her normal workday, and do some face painting, that's fine. That's one of the few times an employee can volunteer for you, because they're not volunteering to do their normal job. They're just volunteering to do something for which other people are also volunteering, because it's just a special event. Having said that, however, I think this is on the next slide, this next point, is what about your special event, your big gala that you have once a year? Maybe you have a couple of galas a year. You know, can you allow your non-exempts to volunteer at that one? Again, best practice is not, especially if the non-exempt who does some kind of admin type work normally is there at the gala checking people in, which is also kind of an admin type function, you're going to want to pay that person for helping out at the gala, even if they say, no, it's fine, I'll volunteer to do it. So how do you make sure that you don't run into trouble with your volunteers? Again, you know, especially your employees who want to volunteer. Don't pay your volunteers anything. Once you start paying money, then it starts to raise the question, what is this money for? You can reimburse them for expenses if, for instance, you're in an area where people drive to your organization to volunteer and they have to pay to be in a parking lot, and you want to reimburse them for that, and they bring you a receipt and you show that this is not pay for services, it's merely reimbursing an individual for expenses, then yes, that's fine. You can go ahead and reimburse the volunteer. And again, have volunteers do work that none of your paid employees are doing. That's fine. Finally, as a best practice, you might want to consider having a sort of a parallel universe for your volunteers. Actually have written volunteer policies. You can even have a written volunteer application, but it should say volunteer application. Don't just use your normal employment application. You can even have volunteer offer letters and making it clear that the person is volunteering to work with your organization. And I believe that is the end of our slides. It is. So as you can see, just closing words, there's a lot to know and a lot of legal consequences There is information out there going on government websites or a great place to help educate yourself about legal risks involved with your employees and even to some extent with your volunteers. So please take advantage of all these resources and make sure you get legal help. There is pro bono legal help available.